Hey, everybody. Dave the Clone back again, and I hope you've got your water cooler cups filled or you're drinking a damn fine cup of coffee, something along the lines of taking a break to have another 15 minutes of movie memory madness. So here we are again, and this time I'm going to be, for the first time probably, and maybe not even for the last during this series, I'm going to go directly from our last episode, talking about the Blair Witch Project, to jump into Book of Shadows, Blair Witch 2. And this one, I'm actually watching the movie right now, sitting here in the in an undisclosed basement for I got a home theater system going, and I've got the volume turned down so as not to interrupt our conversation. But if you do hear anything in the background, I have to apologize because the folks I live with are on the verge of going deaf, and they tend to have their TV very loud in the upstairs part of the house. But in any case, having, you know, just gotten through Halloween and having just talked about the first movie, I was really on sort of a nostalgia trip, thinking back to the years 1999 and 2000 and what was going on for me at that time, being in college, and the fact that the Blair Witch Project had been such a huge cultural phenomenon. And I happened to be kind of scrolling around on the internet and found an article that talked about the director's experience with making the sequel, with Blair Witch 2. Joe Berligner, acclaimed documentarian. I was a big fan of his HBO films, The Paradise Lost. At that time, there was only one of them, I think. Maybe he had, or maybe he had done the second before he did. No, I think, in another little prep moment I had before this episode was watching an event where he, for the first time, watched Blair Witch 2 or Book of Shadows, Blair Witch 2, with an audience of film students. So, you know, this is a movie that was not necessarily loved by and large by not only the world, but even the director himself, because of some things that I wasn't aware of that I've learned through reading some of these articles and watching the Q&A at this event, where I do find it's interesting. I find that when you don't know who the director is, and you haven't ever seen an image of them, you haven't heard their actual own voice, you've only experienced their work, you know, sometimes they're like a mystical name on a screen that your imagination ascribes. You don't necessarily create a picture, I don't think, because I don't think before I ever saw what, you know, Michael Mann looked like that I had pictured a Michael Mann, or Tarantino. You know, Tarantino, you realize he was in the movies, so you did get to see who he was. So there's already kind of a difference in type of filmmaker there. But, you know, Joe Berlinger was somebody who was a behind-the-camera guy. Although I did realize that in the opening sequence here of Blair Witch 2, he is one of, he's a sort of stand-in, I guess. You know, they do this opening sequence where they're interviewing residents of the actual Burkittsville. So to correct the last episode, Burkittsville is a real town that they set this fictional movie in. But I didn't realize going into this movie that the documentary style interviews at the beginning were of actual Burkittsville residents. And then he kind of set in, I guess, just to sort of fill that out. And so that was his little Hitchcock moment cameo in there. But overall, by and large, the story I've learned now, which is very interesting because I loved this movie when it came out. I actually loved it a lot more than the original when I saw it in the theaters. And it was at a time in college where I believe it was my junior year of college. And the year before, so my sophomore year, the summer between my freshman year and sophomore year is when the original Blair Witch came out. And it was right around that time that I was moving from sort of studying writing and thinking that my future was going to be in, you know, trying to become another Stephen King or Dean Koontz and writing novels. And I started dabbling in, you know, I took all the creative writing classes, and there were all different formats that we got to experiment with there. But I started taking playwriting classes as well, and working with some of the folks in the theater department, getting to kind of hang around with actors. And And, you know, I've always loved movies, so there was sort of this kind of thing in my mind where I was like, oh, you know, maybe it's movies. Maybe that's what I want to do. And instead of, you know, doing the smart thing and transferring to a film school, I was like, well, you know, I really love the college I'm at, though, and I picked it because of writing, so let's figure out how to marry these two things. And then around the same time that that thought was coming around, Blair Witch happens, and you kind of get your eyes open to how it's really about your creativity. You don't need a huge Hollywood studio backing you. You don't need a huge budget. Look what these two guys, Eduardo Sanchez and Daniel Myrick, did with the first one and how it was able to take the world by storm. In fact, the summer between my freshman and sophomore year, I got together with a bunch of friends. My friend Suzanne in Delaware had a bunch of us over for kind of like a weekend-long party. It was the second time we had done that. We did that, a bunch of us in this very tight-knit group of friends that I had starting freshman year. The summer between our freshman and sophomore years, we all went to a friend's house in upstate New York, my friend Heather. So this year, this time, this summer, we were visiting my friend Suzanne. And one of my friends, we had already started talking, you know, the last year of, you know, over the summer I'm gonna work and I'm gonna get some money, I'm gonna buy a camera, we're gonna make a movie next year. I'm already working on a screenplay, and some of the scenes from it were scenes I had turned in for my playwriting class, and I was trying to kill as many birds with as few stones as possible. And I remember we're at my friend Suzanne's house, and we're playing asshole, because that was what you did in the late 90s, early 2000s when you were in college. You got a bunch of alcohol and you played card games. And there was at that time, there were mixed reviews amongst the group of friends about the Blair Witch, the initial Blair Witch project. And I realized, too, that the illusion of it being sold as a legitimate documentary, and that it was a true story, and that of course was, you know, diffused by them admitting that it was fake. And I bring this up because that's a big deal for Joe Berlinger, who, as a documentary filmmaker, going into the second one, he had a lot of problems with the fact that the first movie's hype really came from the idea that they were selling to the public this lie, this giant lie about the fact that it was a real documentary. And, you know, I think there, for people who make documentary style movies and projects, especially now, you know, the world I went into in my professional life, going into corporate video, very much closer to documentary style journalism than the dreams I had of making Hollywood style movies, I can kind of see his point. And I'm definitely one of those people who at the time was duped by that that approach. So I think going into the sequel, seeing that they were doing it more as like a traditional movie, but then including these elements that were, you know, what I took at the time to be watching as homages, I thought it was a really great way of making, of trying to bridge the gap between this indie film that had made this huge splash and getting, and kind of marrying it to what we're more used to seeing in Hollywood. So I remember seeing the trailers and being really excited for the second one. But when we were kind of doing our brief stab at trying to make a movie, my friend Alan, when we were at Suzanne's house talking about Blair Witch, and some people were arguing for it, some people were arguing against it, there wasn't a big consensus, Alan's like, are you fucking kidding me? We're gonna make a better movie than that this year, us! And I thought it was interesting that somebody who was gonna be in the movie, as opposed to somebody writing and directing and buying the camera to make the movie, was coming down on that, you know, sort of maybe trying to be proactive and manifest the truth into the future. So that sophomore year, there were some stabs at it, but we never really came together. And I learned an awful lot about how organized and motivational you need to be in order to do something like this, and how it really does help if you have some folks on a team to try to pull something together. And you kind of realize that even though it was an independent film, the first movie, it wouldn't have been what it was if the two filmmakers and whoever they had helping them were just trying to do things by themselves, you know. And then of course you have a bunch of people who think it's a great idea in the beginning, and then they realize, oh, this is actually going to require work. And it sort of goes off the rails. All that said, the property, the idea of the property already kind of had like a little bit of a special place in my heart. So junior year comes around, and realizing that, you know, it had been just about a year since the first movie, and all of a sudden we're seeing trailers for a second movie, there's that skepticism, like, oh man, look at this, the studio's trying to rush out a sequel before everybody starts to kind of lose the heat from the cultural impact of the first movie. So there were already friends who were kind of like, nah, dude, I'm not going to see that, you know. And luckily, there were some people that were in the dorm that I was living in junior year. We basically wound up organizing sort of like a little field trip between myself and a couple of my friends who were also juniors, and then a couple freshmen. This one, it's funny because there was this one girl, there was sort of this little clique of what I would call preppy rich kids who for some reason showed up at this little liberal arts college in Maryland. There was that too, the fact that we were going to school in Maryland, this took place in Maryland. The Blair Witch Project, the original one, was a lot scarier when we got back to school. I actually was a sort of a sophomore guide who was allowed to go on the orientation camping trip with the incoming freshmen, which I had attended as a freshman, and because I remembered such a cool experience to kind of get some team building going on, and then also be able to talk to people who were already in the school for a year, get a sense of what it was going to be like going to college. I was like, oh yeah, I'll do that. And I can't tell you how much scarier being in the woods at night was after seeing the Blair Witch Project. So there was a parallel there between my experience of the first movie and then sort of living in Maryland for that couple of years, and then seeing the way they designed this second movie, where it's all about acknowledging the hype and the impact and the sort of rabid fandom that erupted around cult classics that in the making and new phenomenon. I mean, the entire premise of the second movie is a group of people going on a pilgrimage of sorts, I guess, to Burkittsville to go and see the places where the movie was filmed. And it's very interesting the way they approached it. And I've only learned recently that, you know, the studio had, Artisan Entertainment had commissioned, you know, scripts for a sequel, and they had three options that they could have gone with. And when they approached Joe Berligner, he was taking a meeting with them. This is interesting, and I'm giving you this just as a sort of like modern folklore that I just discovered. But as he was approaching them to do a different project, they basically kind of lied to him and agreed to the meeting, because they knew they were going to ask him to do this second movie. And so, you know, they passed on his idea, but they said, but well, why don't you, you know, take a look at these scripts? We'd really love for you to come in. And I think they wanted to do something very much like repeating the first movie. So it would make sense to have a documentary guy. And instead, he had this idea of like, well, let's explore this whole phenomenon, you know, let's try to figure out this whole sort of thing we're seeing, because, you know, the residents of actual Burkittsville, only a few of them agreed to be interviewed in the beginning of this second film. In fact, from what I understand, they were sort of run out of town. People didn't want them around making a second movie, because in real life, folks were coming down and trying to find the different spots where the movie was filmed. It was sort of like they were being overwhelmed by this sort of tourism that had never existed before. And meanwhile, they're just this little town in Maryland. They're like, what the fuck are all these people doing here? Why are there people leaving all their garbage everywhere and coming out here and camping in our woods and all kinds of stuff? So it's very interesting that they were able to really recreate that for this second movie. And I know, again, I went into it being a little disappointed by the first movie, and it started to maybe grow on me a little bit, but I still was pretty put off by how less of an impact it had when he realized it wasn't a true story. And it's funny because watching this interview with Joe Berlinger now, I mean, he's like, you know, it's like absurd, the idea that people actually thought that that was going to be true, because, you know, wouldn't you think there's something a little morbidly wrong with the fact that Hollywood would be releasing the final moments of these people who disappeared that for all we know are dead, and all the stuff that I was gushing about in the last episode and all the reasons I was excited about the movie and sort of already living into the horror behind that. They're like, we don't really know what happened to these people. So it's kind of neat that they were able to recreate that. And it's funny even talking about it now, realizing how much I am represented on screen by these characters. That's sort of a new connection point for me, because I just remember seeing that it was coming out, convincing some people to come with me to the movies. And one of the people who was actually, it was scary. When we came back to the dorms after watching the movie, I remember kind of being a little creeped out that night, expecting to see, you know, disappearing ghosts and you know, a little girl walking backwards before she faded into nothingness. And I remember there was a moment in the theater where there was a jump scare. It might be when the owl comes crashing through the window. Somebody screamed, one of our group, like literally screamed out loud. I've only been in a theater maybe less than a handful, you know, maybe only two or three times, seeing something scary where an audience member actually screamed at the top of their lungs out of fear, right? And there was this girl, Jess, who I can't remember her actual last name. I just remember the nickname I gave her, which was Jess Popcorn, because about a month after this, she burned popcorn in the microwave in her dorm room and it set off the smoke alarm, and all of us had to, in the, you know, cold of late November going into December, you know, vacate the building and stand outside in our pajamas waiting for the fire department to allow us to go back in. So Jess Popcorn just kind of lets out this shriek in the middle of the movie. And, you know, it was cool. I was such a fan of movies that seeing the Blair Witch being translated into what was much more of a traditional movie, yet still including some of these kind of momentary homages, these techniques, like, you know, one of the characters who's leading this, you know, witch hunt, this sort of tour into the woods of all the places where the Blair Witch took place, and that these kids were all going to camp out in the same places that the folks in the movie who disappeared camped out at. And you get to see, you know, he's got video cameras. You know, it's part of his shtick is that he's got these video cameras that they're going to make their own sort of documentation of what happens to them. And you get to see through those camera lenses, but again, just for very select moments, just for quick, you know, the rest of it was filmed 35 millimeter, filmed like a real movie, so it looked and felt like a real movie. And I, you know, there were things about it that I thought were interesting. I actually was a big fan of flash forwards. I kind of like getting breadcrumbed through a movie and like seeing things that don't make sense. You know, after 94, after Tarantino and Pulp Fiction, the whole idea of just a linear story was kind of boring and old school and passe. You know, the idea of seeing things out of order and knowing that by the end of the movie it should make more sense. There's always a chance it might not make sense, but, you know, the art of that I was a big fan of. So even from the beginning of this movie, we're seeing the documentary style interviews at the beginning, which is sort of an homage to the first movie, bringing us from the first movie to the second movie. And then we see flashes to one of the characters in a mental institution, which I just felt was like a good way of kind of grounding at least one of them and giving us some backstory there. And then as we're moving into the now, you know, and this kind of establishing shot flying over the trees of the woods of Burkittsville, and we're seeing these flashes of like people getting killed, but it's all you know, very close up, like on a knife stabbing into somebody, or ropes being tied around somebody, tying them to a tree, and you're kind of like, what the fuck is this? You know what I mean? And there was that air left by the first movie of, you know, we don't know what happened to those guys, but there was a part where they found this dude's fucking bloody teeth in wrapped in a little package made out of a piece of his torn shirt and in the middle of a bundle of sticks. And so, you know, the sense that there was some violence to becoming a victim of the Blair Witch made things like that feel like they made sense. Now, it's ironic, and Joe, this whole episode is really for you. I'm coming to this as a fan of the movie from the get-go, who thought you did a great job, and it actually is sort of painful for me to read these articles and watch these this Q&A and these interviews with you that this was such a harrowing experience for you. So we also were treated in the beginning of the movie to a flash forward scene of one of the characters. We see one of the characters at first being in an interrogation room with the police coming in ready to start asking questions, and then it cuts to like 3 days prior, you know. So now you're already kind of being set up for, well, whatever happens, whatever those flashes of violence and gore were, they are definitely at the very least going to be accused of it. Now, what I liked about all of this, why I thought it worked, is because knowing that Joe Berlinger had done Paradise Lost on HBO, which is a story about the West Memphis Three, which was a story about these three kids in West Memphis who were accused and convicted of murdering some children in the Robin Hood Hills. And they were really not convicted on any actual evidence or proof. They were convicted on the weird societal kind of Deep South reacting to the fact that these are just the only three guys in town who would dress in all black and listen to Metallica. The whole town sort of assumed that they were, you know, Satan worshipers. And so it was very much like a guilty by association type thing. And even in the several years from when that happened, that was like in the early 90s, that documentary came out. And over the years, there was so much that came out about how the police just really needed to find people to pin this murder on, and they didn't know how to solve this crime. You know, go figure, West Memphis didn't understand how to solve a fucking crime with forensics. And they actually strong-armed people into lying and saying that they had seen these kids, you know, and that, or that, I know one of the kids was sort of mentally less developed than the others, had sort of some kind of a mental, I don't even know what the PC way of saying that is, but they would say mentally challenged. And he was the one that was browbeaten into confessing. And so once that happened, it didn't matter, no matter what these guys said. And they were close to being executed at one point, too. And so all this to say that in this movie, they play with this idea of, it may not even necessarily need to be provable that these people did anything. Once the police have them and are ready to, you know, pin the responsibility on them, it's sort of like not going to necessarily matter, you know, whether they did it or not. But then what happens in this movie, I think, actually not only continues the thread of the sort of supernatural side of the first movie, it continues it in such a way that it sets the mythology of the Blair Witch universe, which then gets picked up and run with in the third movie. And I think the third movie is actually sort of the best marriage of all worlds, to bring it back to the feel of the original, but to bring the Hollywood movie sense that this movie creates and really makes it work. And I hope that there's more movies on the way. But, you know, to kind of pin it down, you know, these folks go out into the woods, they go camping, and on the first night, so what I always found the funny thing, the only moment of incredulity, I don't know, I'm definitely butchering that word, was that, you know, they go into the woods on this, you know, planned tour, but they also are partying like my friends and I at college would party. Like, they were trying to drink themselves into oblivion. They were smoking a ton of weed. You imagine there might have been something even more on the psychedelic tip. And they all wake up after basically blacking out. And it's kind of like, well, duh. You know what I mean? Like, we were all kind of watching in the theater going, all right. So they drank themselves into oblivion, and then they wake up and the whole campsite is like destroyed. Two of the characters are people who are writing a book about the Blair Witch, and they wake up to sort of snow falling, but it's not really snow. It's the shredded pages of their book being blown around by the wind. The tour guide, played by Jeff Donovan, his cameras are all smashed, and they all have that sort of weird, uncomfortable, almost the way I've seen some, you know, victims of alien abductions describe this. I know something happened, and almost can maybe sometimes, you know, rape survivors as well. Like, I know something happened, but I can't remember it because I was so wasted, I was drugged, whatever, the aliens wiped my mind. And so, you know, the rest of the movie becomes this mission for them to try to figure out what happened last night. And even though the cameras are destroyed and everything, the tapes are left behind, and they're left in the same spot where the original Blair Witch tapes were found. Now, I don't know if because of it being more of a Hollywood movie, I bought into the supernatural stuff right away. I'm all about the idea that these kids were all manipulated by the Blair Witch, or affected or possessed by the Blair Witch. And the way the movie plays out, a lot of these sort of scenes that take place after they go back to Jeff's house and are trying to piece together using the tapes, digitizing the tapes and editing, looking through the tapes to figure out what happened. There are different moments, like one of the characters goes to get more beer, and while she's out, she has an altercation with the woman working at the grocery store. And we see the scene play out. And then when she gets back to Jeff's house, there's like a bloody nail file in the grocery bag, and she's looking at it like, how did this get here? And there are things that happen where other characters, you know, wind up being found dead, and you don't know how it happened. And then at the end of the movie, these interrogation scenes get played up, and the police have, you know, closed circuit TV from the grocery store where it shows the girl murdering the woman who worked there with the nail file, stabbing her in the throat. And we see the footage of Jeff's internal security cameras showing him murdering one of the women. And what I actually thought that was this sort of like brilliant reprisal of sort of what was happening to the West Memphis 3. And I felt like that was Joe Berlinger bringing that in, the idea that they lived a different reality than what these cameras all picked up all around them, and that the cameras showed them doing these horrific things that they don't remember doing. Now, the movie makes a case for it to be that the Blair Witch did this to them, and in her possession of them, her manipulation of them, that's part of the glamour of it, was that, or the glimmer, whatever they called it in The Craft. Glamour, I believe, is the spell in The Craft, where part of her power is to hypnotize you so you don't know what you're doing. And I don't know. I mean, I don't know I think there are a lot of people, the people who do like this movie, buy into that as well. And I don't mean to speak for them. That's a hypothesis of mine. But I wonder, because hearing Joe Berlinger's description of what he was really going for was that the sort of obsession with the first movie, the sort of collective delusion that comes from the sort of being an obsessive fan, they actually knowingly committed these crimes and were able to use this kind of collective delusion to alleviate themselves of their own guilt. And I think it's a really interesting premise. I feel like I just like it better that it was the Blair Witch. You know what I mean? I feel like I like the idea of the Blair Witch being an actual horror movie entity. And then when you see the third movie, Blair Witch from 2016, they fully embrace the Blair Witch as a presence, as an entity, as an evil. In fact, they even expand on the woods of Burkittsville being sort of more like this labyrinth that once you're there, it's very likely you're not going to be able to get out if the Blair Witch doesn't want to let you. And in fact, going back to the second one here, with that in mind, it's kind of a wonder that they were allowed to leave the woods to go back to Jeff's house and sort of, but that was, again, Berlinger trying to move the movie from the first one where it was this sort of just documentary of these kids lost in the woods to, well, let's make it more of a haunted house. And the end of the first one did have a haunted house in it, but this was a different kind of haunted house. In any case, I've done an awful lot of spoiling of the movie, so if anybody's listening to this or watching this on YouTube, one, make sure to smash that like button and subscribe and click the bell icon so that you're, you know, updated every time we release some new content here on the Hollow Nine Network. But for those of you who've never seen it before, I hope I haven't ruined your experience, but I'm very interested to hear what you think when you watch it. If you remember seeing these movies when they came out, what it was like, what you remember about that time, what were you doing at that time, and if these movies are movies you still watch, if they've grown on you, if your memory of them has changed as time has gone on. All right, we have now officially doubled the 15 minutes into a half hour, so before people hate me for being a liar, I'm going to take my leave, but thank you for checking in. It's time to get back to work. Break is over, and we'll be back on another episode of 15 Minutes of Movie Memory Madness. I have been Dave the Clone, and it has been a pleasure reading through the Book of Shadows, Blair Witch 2.
You've been listening to the Hollow Nine Network, bringing you the very best in fan-made media. That's the word hollow, the number 9, I-N-E. Find the Hollow Nine Network on Facebook. Follow us on Twitter, Instagram, and Snapchat. Rate and review us on iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play, or wherever you find your podcasts. Email us at hollow9podcast@gmail.com. Leave us your feedback. Join in the conversation and be a part of the action. Join in the fun. Hollow Nine.